بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسول الكريم أما بعد لا تقوم الساعة حتى يؤتمن الخائن قيامت will not occur until the treacherous unreliable people will be considered to be trustworthy, upright and honest. So a time will come in the Ummah where people who are notorious for treachery and crimes and evil will be considered to be amongst the most upright, trusted people on earth. Whether it's on a micro level, where it is in a family, a locality, a town, or an individual, or a macro level, where internationally governments perpetrate crimes, harm humanity, and still people rely on them and speak great about them. And continuing about the virus in Wuhan, where there was a full lockdown on January 23rd. So no domestic travel was allowed, but traveling abroad was allowed. 31st January, Trump gets intel from the intelligence agencies. He does and applies a travel ban on China. By that time, 381,000 people had traveled to the USA. Backing up China's opinion, which was covered up of non-human transmission, now they backed up that there was no reason for international travel to be blocked. Tedros made the statement. And up to 30th March, travel was still open internationally. After knowing the seriousness of the situation, why did China apply a lockdown internally, yet they allowed travel abroad? Another question, look at the medical supplies. In early January, they imposed export restrictions on medical supplies. And they were importing as much medical supplies as they could they get their hands on. Just a Taiwanese company who was one of the biggest non-woven cloth manufacturers, when they were contacted, and this is 27th of January, they could not supply anything. Why? Because China had purchased the entire arsenal, the entire supply of non-woven cloth from India as much as possible. And then up to the beginning of January, there were cyber attacks on US and European vaccine companies to get and extract information. So different laboratories had done tests and they had found that it was like SARS-like some symptoms. On the 1st January, when one of the laboratories had found and released a statement showing and endorsing the fact that this was like SARS, all the samples were destroyed and they were forbidden to release any information to the outside world. So the question is, why were these labs closed down? Why was the data made confidential? Another lab in China released a report and encouraged medical staff and people to take safety measures. And the same laboratory was shut down as well. Another laboratory prepared the full virus genome, a Hong Kong laboratory. They were also made to shut down and all their samples, etc., were taken away and they were warned not to release any information, to transmit any information, to inform any info to the media and to keep everything confidential. Question mark. Why did they want to destroy the genome sequence? Why didn't they want the world to know the sequence Why? Because the sequence is like a family tree. All the mutations become visible, the history. Basically, it's a molecular clock. April 17th, where Cambridge University prepared some data, and when they looked at the genome sequence, their focus was that possibly the virus became prevalent in September, possibly October, November, but they dated it back up to that time. And if we look at all other reports of other laboratories and universities where they were saying October, how come so much months down the line was the world not informed? And as discussed, Dr. Shijian Li, in November 11th, when they came across a cave which hosted thousands of bats, and they found that there were bats which had 10 coronaviruses, they were hosts of this coronavirus. They took thousands of bats and samples from these caves. But she released a statement when the outbreak happened that there was no genome to match that to bats. Again, question mark. So the genetic mutation which occurred on a molecular level and cells get infected and there are different strains. When these strains were applied on rats, then the sequence shows that normally it cannot jump. The mutation is limited to a species, but only a laboratory prepared virus could have jumped. And these are words of many experts. Another question, why were foreign experts denied access to the market, which was supposedly where the virus originated? No access was given. And then, if you look at just all the crimes that has been committed, and we'll get into that inshallah, why were they not accountable? Why has nobody been held accountable? Accountability for what? If we look at the largest famine, one of the deadliest, greatest man-made disasters in human history, it's called the Great Leap Forward Famine, which occurred between 1959 and 1961. They say approximately 45, some researchers say 55 million lives were lost. One person reports, I took a travel on a long distance bus. Out of the window, I saw corpses in ditches. Nobody said anything. We came to one area, almost one third of the entire populace were dead, and bodies were lying everywhere. But the local leaders were enjoying good meals and liquor. And whoever dared to say anything, they were killed. Another person says, I went to one village and I saw 100 dead bodies. And just bodies everywhere, and nobody paying attention to them. Just around 2.5 million people were victims and were beaten and were tortured by the Chinese government. During this famine as well, what supposedly caused it was that people were made to go and work. The peasants were ordered to leave the agricultural farms and go into the steel mills, and they were prevented from cultivating and owning their own plots and produce. So people starved, one reporter says, people starved at the doors of grain warehouses. As they died in front of the grain houses, they were shouting, save us, save us. If just the granaries, and not all of it, they say none or no deaths would have occurred. And as people were dying in large numbers, the officials were only worried about fulfilling the delivery of grain. So we're dealing with a group of people who didn't mind, didn't concern, didn't worry of their own populace, 45 to 55 million of their own population. Then if we look at 1989, 100,000 college students in Tiananmen Square demonstrated, they screamed and cried for democracy and free speech. But it's famous for the Tiananmen massacre. Some reports have said 10,000 people were killed where the Chinese military fired live ammunition. 250,000 troops entered Beijing. So there's been cover-ups after cover-up. We know about the oppression. This is on their own people. Imagine the Muslim, the Uyghurs. It is famous about the oppression that has been happening throughout time. And the Chinese government has imposed religious oppression and zulm. They have expanded the surveillance to watch for and determine religious extremism. You can't even own an Islamic book, Quran, grow a beard, have a musalla. If anybody doesn't smoke or drink, then is regarded as an extremist. They've even installed cameras in their homes. These are private citizens. And they say possibly 1 million Uyghurs are detained in mass detention camps. And they've termed it re-education camps. They want to change the political thinking of the detainees. They say their identities and their beliefs are incorrect. Some of these facilities keep prisoners detained permanently. The inmates cannot go home. And the Chinese government are operating all these camps trying to indoctrinate people with the CCP ideology. Inmates are held captive 12 months, 18 months, years and years, and nobody knows what's going on. They are told to sing praises of the Chinese Communist Party, writing self-criticism essays. The prisoners are subject to physical, verbal abuse, and they monitor families of current inmates who have been detained. Some reporters say even sterilization, mandatory birth control has been implemented to force women to abort children because they don't want the increase in Muslim population. Forget that, even the masajid between 2016 and 2018, satellite evidence suggests that over 2,000 masajid religious sites have been destroyed. And this separation also has been done so that the demographics and the procreation structure is disrupted of the Muslims. So, zulm of an unprecedented level. Millions of adults have been detained. They say in 2017 alone, 500,000 children have been detained. They've been placed in preschool camps, in prison-style surveillance systems, with fences, 10,000 volts fences. In the New York Times article 2019, it was reported that the Chinese government were collecting DNA. Why? Because they wanted to systematically destroy the entire population and generation. And they mutilated cemeteries as well. So up to now, last year, 2019, 22 countries, which most of them were non-Muslim countries, from Australia to UK to Canada to France to Germany to Japan, they raised their concerns about these camps. And just after that, in July 2019, ambassadors of 50 countries issued a joint letter to the president of the UN Human Rights Council and the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, showing support for China. What Nabi Alayhi Salaam said, that the treacherous people will be regarded as trustworthy. 50 countries, despite all this condemnation, despite the detention of 2 million Muslims. Can we imagine what zulm and what oppression and what level this has happened? And why was this allowed? Why are they not accountable? As President mentioned previously, the agenda of the global new world order has shifted, and they've not put their eggs in one basket. The second basket is China. We look at 1989, Bush arrived and he consoled the president and authorized military supplies. That was when the Tiananmen Square massacre happened. A president of a foreign country literally congratulates another president on the massacre of his civilians. Then Bill Clinton, when before he came in power, he promoted the fact that he will be tough on China. But after he came to office, sanctions on China were lifted. Look at the double standards. Sanctions on China were lifted. China was helped to be part of the World Trade Organization. And America gave China the status of the most favored nation. From technology-wise, whether it's Cisco, Oracle, Microsoft, IBM, they assisted China in monitoring the population. It's called the Golden Shield Project. If you look at the finance and economy, JP Morgan Chase and all the other big institutes channeled a lot of money. They gave prime positions to senior politicians, their children. Morgan Stanley had channeled trillions. And if we just look at one company which is part of Morgan Stanley, which is Tencent, they own WeChat and they help to monitor for the CCP. When the doctor released the statement, it was on the WeChat. So we find that Zulum is happening on an unprecedented level, and the people of Batil will plan, but Allah is the best of planners. The people of Iman need to have an idea. We say, tell somebody, okay, abstain, don't support that country. But we don't have infrastructure. We haven't prepared. Our mind hasn't gone in a direction. So it's important to know, as the people of Iman, we should have knowledge and prepare externally and internally. And this example of what is happening is like a professor that entered his classroom. He told his students, I'm going to give you a surprise test. They all waited anxiously, something new. Exam is going to start. The professor gave out all the documentation, the exams. The text was facing down. And then once he handed all the papers out, he told everybody, you can turn the paper over. Everybody turned it over, but there were no questions. It was just a black dot in the center of the paper. The professor seen all the expression on people's faces and he said, I want you to write something of what's on the paper. Students were confused. They didn't know what to write. Instructions were not clear. So everybody wrote whatever they thought. The professor collected all the paper and he read aloud what all the students had written. All the students, without one student exception, noted the importance of the black dot. They explained the position, they explained the size, they explained everything about the black dot. So the professor, now teaching them a lesson, said, I will not grade you, I will not give you a mark. I just wanted you to learn something. Nobody in the entire class wrote about the white paper. Everyone focused on the black dot. And that's what happens in life also. People focus on the dark spots, but they don't focus on the whiteness around it. Same thing happening in the world today. That there's so much darkness happening that people, there's a page that is black and there's one white spot. And people are speaking good about the white spot of these people of Batil and these governments. Nobody is seeing the darkness. The amal for today is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives somebody some goodness. فَعَلِمَ أَنَّهَا مِنَ اللَّهِ. Any bounty, and you acknowledge that it is from Allah, illa kataba Allahu lahu shukraha. You will get the reward of fulfilling the shukr and the gratitude even before he says Alhamdulillah. وَمَا أَذْنَبَ عَبْدٌ ذَنْبًا فَنَدِمَ عَلَيْهِ. Any servant commits a guna and has regret, إِلَّا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَهُ مَغْفِرَتَهُ قَبْلَ أَن يَسْتَغْفِرَهُ. Before even he makes istighfar and says it on his tongue, Allah forgives him. And anybody who purchases any clothing, even though it's a small amount, فَلَبِسَهُ, and he wears it, فَحَمِدَ اللَّهُ, and he praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives him. May Allah give us tawfiq of making amal. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.